Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, my name is Tom Majkut, and for my whole life I have been seeking some kind of approval. It must be because I've always wanted a nickname. And so at a very early age, I failed at this because I tried to name myself. I had a really close friend. His nickname was Digger, for Di Gregorio. So I was like, no one can really say my name. It's M-A-J-K-U-T, pronounced Majkut. But it's usually pronounced by other people as Majkut, 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 and maybe just spelled out in general, M-A-J-K-U-T, are you there? And so for my whole life, I have had this name, but my full name, my on paper full name is Thomas Edward Francis Xavier Carrasco Alvarez Majkut. I can use that legally. Let me explain. I'm adopted. I'm not from here. I'm an alien, but I'm legal. But there was some confusion about that at some point anyway, so I had to clear that up too. But I come from South America. I was adopted as a very young child, and I have lived in Massachusetts my whole life. And growing up in Massachusetts has been amazing. I grew up in a small town in central Massachusetts called Upton. It's a four-way stop to literally anywhere else that's interesting. So I grew up in a neighborhood. Some people called it Candy Cane Lane because it was one of the only neighborhoods growing up where in town where kids on Halloween could just do the circle a couple of times and, you know, parents were just happy to just keep filling the bags. But I grew up in a neighborhood of 12 boys my age. And that was just a nightmare. We were everywhere. And this was back when, you know, kids just ran around in the street. And, you know, it was just like, oh, we got a straight downhill vertical here. Why don't we lay on our stomachs on skateboards and just fly down? Because we don't have any concern about cars coming around the corner. That's fine. So growing up, all the way up until fourth grade, about 10 years old, I had the best life ever. I had every single thing in front of me, and I said, this is always going to be strong. Everyone moved away except for three of us. Myself, my friend Matt, who went to a Catholic school in Worcester, and my friend Richard, who was a year younger than me. And at that point, when you're about 10 years old, it's like he's basically in another school system. So my best friend in the world, he had moved away. I was very much vulnerable and alone, 10 years old, going into a regional school system, joining up with other kids from other school systems that I'd never met in the town next to us. And I'm outside that summer playing with my X-Men action figures by myself, near the road, apparently just looking for sympathy. Maybe someone will come by and give me lemonade. And there's a house for sale a couple of houses down, and this kid walks up to me and he says, my family's thinking about moving into town. And I'm just kind of staring at him, and he's like, my name's Chad. And I was like, hey, do you want to play X-Men? And he goes, I love X-Men. And I was like, I love X-Men. These are two things that are cool about us. So we played X-Men, and at that moment, years and years later, he would tell me that the reason his family moved into town was because of him and because of me, because we liked X-Men. And I was like, your family made a critical life decision based on my hoarding obsession of X-Men action figures. You might want to rethink that. But we moved in, and for the first time as a kid, the months of turmoil seemed like years, but I felt like great weights had been lifted. I had a best friend again. I don't know why, but I was like, he likes X-Men, he's my best friend, the end. That's good, let's make this simple. Chad Di Gregorio Digger, he was like, you need a nickname. And I was like, I do need a nickname. I don't know if I told you about this, but I kind of, you know, I've been thinking of one. He's like, well, what do you got? And I was like, all right, check this out. It's Tusk. And he's like, Tusk? I'm like, yeah, he's this X-Men guy. He's like, huge and he's got these tusks. And he was like, yeah, that's not, I'm never going to call you tusks. that's never going to happen. And I was like, oh, okay, well, if you know better, then why don't you name me? He's like, I'm just going to call you Tommy. And of course, inside, I'm like, Go Power Rangers! Yes! I did it! I always wanted to be costumed. Finally, somebody picked up on that fact. Oh, this is fantastic. And, you know, it's not one of those things, you can't just, like, as a Tom, you can't just go around and be like, everyone's called me Tom or Thomas my whole life, I'm just going to start being like, hi, I'm Tommy. You know, in some way, it always felt like I'd be putting myself at kind of a juvenile level, because I thought of Tommy Pickles, and I was like, I already got Thomas the Tank Engine. I tried to get away from that. Now I have Tom that's kind of too old for how old I am at this point. Tusk isn't going to work out. So here I am, my friend, saying, you're Tommy. And then years and years later, my wife, when I first met her, she was like, you're Tommy the Shark. And I was like, yeah. I am Tommy the Shark. It's because of my stone cold demeanor, right? And I'm just like, oh, you know? And she was like, no, it's because your last name is Mako. This is about a month in. And I said, my last name is not Mako. And she's like, oh. Like, so I wasn't Tommy the Shark because I... And she's like, no. Okay, well, I'm just regular little Tommy the Shark then. So, to begin my experience leveling up, those things are necessary to know. Because I truly believe that the people that interact with you, that know you the most in life, they look you in the eye and say, this is who you are to me. To my friend Chad, I was Tommy. And I got to embrace that in a way where it felt legitimate, and I was like, this is how you know me. You have, your influence has gotten other people to call me this. This is how they know me. There are now connections going in between all of us, leading all the way up to here, my involvement in this store, working close with Sam, working close with these events, this room in itself and everyone sitting here. I can't thank you enough for being here. Everything that we do and go into this, my fake kamikaze persona as Tomikaze, my fake look sharp band persona as Tommy Sharp, because I thought it would be funny to have like a Van Halen reference in there. You know, like, oh yeah, in an interview they'll be like, so Tom, where did the band name come from? You're listed here as Tommy Sharp. Is that kind of like a Van Halen thing? And I would just respond like, and it would go something like that. But the people that give you a nickname, they somehow see through you and they see right to who you are. Chad was no different. And to start this story off Wonka style, we're going to start at the end. We're going to flash forward to the present, which was 2 years ago. And then we're going to flash forward even more to the present, which is right now. So at the end of the story, or close to the end of the story here, and it'll get better, but my best friend Chad has passed away. He was an archaeologist, and believe me when I say this, this gets really resoundingly positive, or as positive as it's going to get. My friend Chad, he was an archaeologist, and he was as close to being a real-life Indiana Jones as that you could ever imagine. He, from the moment we were kids, we knew that there was something out there for us that we couldn't quite understand. We didn't connect with a lot of different groups of people. We were very friendly with human beings, but organizational groups of these types of things never sat with us. To be honest, it sounds so weird. It sucks to admit stuff like this. It doesn't make any sense, but we were essentially teenage anarchists. But we were stone sober. We weren't straight edge. We liked punk rock music. That didn't matter. We never messed with anybody's personal property, but we loved really fucking up, like, commercial property. Like, we just fucking hated it. Like, we would throw bricks through windows, and we would rip out flower beds. I'm so sorry to say this. We'd rip out flower beds and put salt bags in the ground because we saw it on Simpsons. Ruin the earth. We did this anywhere we went. We'd go up to New Hampshire to stay at some really nice place, and you know, we'd be walking around late at night, and we'd just be like, God, tip over all of these nice statues. And I don't know why we felt like this was what we wanted to do, but we were obviously trying to express something together and understand more about this physical world around us, because I think a lot of it seemed temporary to us, like we were supposed to be interacting with it in a different way. He was a known genius. His IQ level was always somewhere in the ether that nobody could really touch, but always looked at me with sincerity. He always looked at me and said, I understand your intelligence. And I have tried to look at every single person in my life with that same level of respect and intelligence. And it's hard because I'm wearing sunglasses on the stage because I know those lights are there. But it has gotten to the point where as a performer, no matter how many stages I've been on, I feel more comfortable behind these lenses looking out at people, because I feel like there's a part of me I can express through this. Now, this is only recent. I usually like to take my sunglasses off and see everybody and look people in the eye and be really sincere about it, but I've found that in order to say more personal things, I like to kind of have a character persona, and I have a lot of different character personas. And what the hell does all of this have to do with leveling up? So, yes, my friend passing away is a pivotal moment. He was an archaeologist, like I said, in Turkey. He's been to Greece. He was the Dr. Ian Malcolm of his field. He was on his way to being the rock star name in archaeology, the top name in all of archaeology. Some of his discoveries that he made has reset the human history of understanding of seafaring human beings back 3,000 years. This means that all of us connected at some level, our understanding of how old we truly are as unique minds and connected people, it dates back before we've even understood it, and it's still being explored. Those are the types of things archaeologists are looking at right now, all over the world, particularly in Crete, in Greece, and in Turkey. He was in Turkey, and he said it was an absolute hell, because at 5 a.m., an alarm would go off that sounded like an air raid siren, which is lots of yelling, so you were up. He set out one day by himself, because there is no such thing as shared credit in archaeology. If you make that discovery with someone else, it's 50-50. If you discover it yourself, you make a name for yourself. And we were always after not the credit, not the name on the thing. We wanted to see it with our own eyes, ourselves, and be the people that were there alone to see it. We had talked about this at length throughout our life together, about just seeing these moments, being here on stage and saying any of this. This is a moment for me to level up. So as he's ascending a mountain by himself, and he's just identified out of geological structures and potential human access where people thousands of years ago may have dwelled for just even a bit, he fell in pursuit of climbing to something that he believed in. Now, am I supposed to be proud of his death like a Klingon? That he died in pursuit of the thing that he loved the most? I've never been able to bring myself to it, but the idea is so alluring to me. It's such a romanticized idea to love the people that we lose in this larger-than-life kind of way. But the scenario in which he passed away was so traumatic, so abrupt, so sudden. I was on my way to a wedding. I was seeing a dear friend of mine that I had lived with in college. He was getting married to a dear friend of ours in college as well. And we were driving up to Maine, and in my head, this is the first time my wife and I have been able to have a vacation in 2 years. It's only 4 days, but I'm so excited. And we are going up to Maine, and in my head, my band is trying to release this album, and it's coming out in October, and his birthday's in October, and I'm just so excited because we had been working on all sorts of tight fonts, and we really wanted to get back to the roots of, you know, hardcore and old school punk rock, where each band had their own signature design for their name. And I was like, you know, that's kind of like a lost art in the days of modern typesetting and all the things that you can do on Photoshop. But as I'm thinking about this, I'm like, Chad's going to be home in just 1 week. He told me he was going off to look at one more thing before he gets home. I can't wait to see him. He's going to have all these pictures. I'm going to be bored to tears because they're all going to look the same. Just a bunch of rocks. Covered in dirt. He always had the dirtiest hands I've ever seen anyone have. So I'm driving and I get a phone call. Normally, I don't pick up the phone while I'm driving, and that's just what I'm saying because I always pick up the phone while I'm driving. And it's my dad. Hey, Dad, how's it going? What's going on? And he's like, well, I have some bad news. And I'm like, okay. And he says that Chad's had an accident. And I said, that's not surprising. We used to walk to school together, and every time he would step out into the road, I would have to grab him by the back of the shirt and pull him back and say, you're going to die. Because what the hell is your problem? Why do you not look when you walk into a street? And that is just super genius. Walks into the middle of a road. I don't see how the two go together, but they do. So there's been a part of me my whole life, and this is going to sound weird, that has known that he was going to die. I always knew that one of my friends was going to die, and I always knew that he was going to be the one. And for as many times as we had watched Indiana Jones and Jurassic Park and any of these like would-be adventure epics of the individual going out and facing the most extreme conditions the world has to offer, we always somehow believed, whether we were anarchists or scholars, that we would charge through hell and come out the other side and just be fine. And I always just said, all right, you know, we've been through a lot. We were backyard wrestlers. You used to put me through a table. I guess I should trust you. And every time he left, I was just pit in my heart. I was, please be safe. I hate when you send me pictures of you scaling a waterfall. It looks awesome, but could you just not do that? All you gotta do is sit in the library and write. I mean, Dr. Jones would be a little disappointed, but I think it would prove something. And you know, to truly tell this story is to tell a story about me, because he held half of my identity. I have since had to cobble together these memories because I didn't choose to remember them anymore. They were very painful to look at and to go back through my life and to realize that in so many instances he was there for every single moment and I relied on him to remember this stuff. All of this is going through my head on the phone while I'm driving, desperately trying to pull off the road. It is just a massive wave of every thought I've ever had. I pull over to the side of the road. We're about 10 minutes away from where we're going, in Old Orchard Beach in Maine, to see my friend for his wedding. And at this moment, I have a very real task. My dad didn't just call me because he wanted to tell me that Chad had passed away. He called me because he said Barbara, his mother, would like to make sure that every single person that is connected to him does not find out about this through Facebook, through a text, through hearsay, because this is going to be confusing, because he's not in this country. He's nowhere we can tangibly even understand this. He's gone. So what do you do in that moment when you can no longer grieve? You have to summon strength beyond what you believe is even possible for yourself. And you have to start assembling not only a list of everybody that you know, but it starts really hitting you how many people this guy's life touched. So I called on the side of my road after kicking my car and screaming, and I let me see if I can get this right. Only posers die, you fuck! Anyone seen SLC Punk? But that's literally what I screamed while I'm kicking the side of my car. And I was like, I'm going to be arrested for it. I mean, this is Maine, so I don't know. They're going to be like, listen, Boston guy, why don't you get lost and take your crying fit tantrum back to Boston. So I gathered as much courage as I could for myself. And I went out and I picked up the phone and I started calling every single person. And every single person that I talked to had the same exact reaction. They said, what? And I was, oh my God, that's the exact same reaction I had. And I basically tried to be as sincere with each one of them as possible, knowing that I could only spend minutes with them. They're at work. I'm calling them in the middle of the day. I'm saying it's an emergency, it's urgent. I'm texting, I'm calling back. They know it's urgent, they're getting back to me. To call every one of your best friends, break their heart, break their world, their understanding of what's around them, that in those moments I said, I either am going to internalize this and do some damage right now to myself, and I don't know what the future is going to hold for my emotional stability going forward, but I know that I have to do this right, because he's not even here. It's not just today. It's when I get home and everyone still has those same questions. It's 2 weeks later when everyone's still wondering, where's his body? Where is he in the world? And what does this all mean to me? What types of commitments can I even make? And you make so many commitments in those moments to people that you don't realize. Start looking at people's families more directly and saying, I'm going to be there for you. This loss is so hard, but I'm not going to let you go through it alone. I didn't know at the time that I couldn't fulfill stuff like that. I didn't know at the time that I could look at people and say, you know, I'm going to be here and be strong for you. And I was. I carried him down in the church. His family was the most humbling experience that I could have possibly had. I carried him with his family into the church, into the cemetery. I got to give his eulogy, which I kid you not, we were such Star Trek nerds that I almost took Kurt's speech about Spock in Wrath of Khan verbatim. And I was this close to delivering that, but I was like, yeah, I don't know, family members must have seen Wrath of Khan at some point, and they're going to be like, seriously, right now you're going to do this. So instead, what I did is, while I was writing his eulogy, I watched Yesterday's Enterprise, which just completely made me break down. Yesterday's Enterprise is a Next Generation episode in which the Enterprise C has come face to face with the Enterprise D. The Enterprise C has been missing in time for years and years. They were all killed in an accident. And for the first time in so long, Tasha Yar is back, part of this new crossed universe that everybody is experiencing. And that moment for me, I got to see him just briefly. And every single day, I've got to see him briefly. And what has it done to me? What has it done to my young punk rock self? My sense of nostalgia, my sense of existing, for being fragile. It made me scared. I stopped riding my bike in the streets. I became so sheltered from what reality was that I started seeing everything hostily. I started disassociating myself from my environment. The stress and pressures of life were already building. I'd been evicted. Nah, I'm on the court. I was doing pretty good, but, you know, Orthodontist got some money and he wants to move some people in, so. Things go wrong in an instant. You get laid off 3 times for me. You lose people in your life. Important people that you just realize you can't go. Like, we were going to move off into the woods together, build some kind of commune. That's what we had always talked about. We were like, I wasn't going to go back into being in a band. I wasn't going to pursue comic books in a sincere way. I wasn't going to do any of this, because he was so close to finishing his archaeology degree that after the end of that, we were pretty damn sure we were going to buy a piece of land with our friends somewhere in some mountainous area and start just building our own area to live. This is how crazy my outlook on my life used to be. When I first moved in with my wife, my girlfriend at the time, we lived in a barn. We would have punk rock shows there all the time in the living room because we had 20-foot high ceilings. Chad slept on every couch. He was just living with me all the time. We lived all over each other. We loved the same music. We loved the same bands. Our whole identity was entwined. And what happens when you remove that, it's like removing venom from Eddie Brock. It just doesn't, the two just want to talk to each other all the time, but you can't. And you end up trying to be mad at God, but you're like, I didn't go to that much church, and damn it. You know, we got confirmed together. We hated God at the time. We were, you know, we were always trying to be like atheism, blah, 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 and write a book. And, you know, but we didn't want to be jerks about it. But so our confirmation name, going back to my long xylophone name, the Charles, the Francis Xavier part is St. Francis Xavier. And I literally chose it because, A, my cousin, who's older than me, chose Magnus. And at some point, I was like, I really want to be a professor. The both of us always wanted to be professors. And I was like, I can actually call myself Professor X. I will be Professor Xavier. And his name was Chad Michael DiGregorio. So being an asshole, he chose the confirmation name of Michael. So he is Chad Michael DiGregorio. What a name. So I'm trying to deal with the fact that I don't feel like I remember myself anymore. I don't remember what we did for years. I don't remember high school anymore. I don't remember the last 6 years. I just remember the days leading up to him leaving and every day that he wasn't there, because he just never came back. And I started realizing that sometimes those things just never come back to us. Sometimes the things that ground us the most are the things that are the easiest to take away in an instant. How do you build a support structure for yourself that allows for absolute chaos? You go back to being an anarchist. And part of that is realizing my place within structure. I need to be talking to more people. I need to be here to tell some of these things, because no matter the fact that I've played in bands since I've been 13 years old, that I've gone on a lot of different stages, I play some very interesting characters. You may have seen one of them. I have a lot of different voices. All of this show means very little to me personally. It's just something that I find interesting, compelled to do. And when he died, I tried my hardest. I was like, I'm going to release an album that's going to change the way that people look at alternative music. I'm going to write a comic book. I'm going to work at a comic book store. I'm going to work 40 hours a week for another business. I'm going to get laid off from that business. I'm going to take another job, work 70 to 80 hours a week at that job. I'm going to leave that place and go work at a college now. And that's where I'm at right now. As of the last 2 weeks, I have finally aligned myself up more suited with my interests in my own life. And I'm not bragging about that or saying that to say that I've landed on something that I feel is going to set me up for the future and be concrete for me, my wife, my life, my family, my friends, all of you. It's not going to make me a better performer. What makes me a better performer is being able to take off my sunglasses and look people in the eyes and say thank you. Thank you for allowing me to be awkward, to be indirect, to be scattered for the last years of my life, to put on shows for other people's sake, to be generous and anarchistic with my time. Because the true rebellion that I have for myself is to never microtize, monetize, or look at my time as the thing that's the most valuable. Time is not valuable, or should not be valuable for me or any of us. It's fleeting. It could be gone the second you leave here. Ugh. That's not going to happen. But it could. And I don't want to look away from things like this anymore. I want to look at people and be a cognizant, full whole of myself. I don't want to have dead behind my eyes. I don't want to be a drone. I don't want to have to hold in daily conversations with other people at workplaces and complain about the mundane anymore. If you have something to complain about, if it's really boiling you, I'm going to be there to listen instead. I'm going to be there to look you in the eye and say, you know, I'm not going to feed into this. I'm not going to tell you what to do. I'm never going to limit you or tell you how you should live. But I just want you to know that you are capable of rising above at all times, viewing your time as endless and moving on to the next thing you truly want to do. So spend your time exactly where you want it. Write, create, walk, go outside, literally look people in the eye, And that's something that we worked on so much, looking each other in the eye and being confident that the things we were doing for each other were going to level us up at all times. Never give up. Crash and burn if you have to, but continue going forward. And in his absence, all I have is going forward. All I have is confidence now, because for you, for the performance, for talking about something that is sincere to me, this opportunity has truly allowed me to move on into another area of my life as I prepare with another lifelong best friend, known him since we were in preschool, drummer in our band. I didn't say my band, Ben. And I get to continue to surround myself with the people that inspire me to be a better person every day and work harder every day. And I can't thank you all enough for allowing me the opportunity to come here and say this. This has leveled me up to a point where I'm not shaking. I can talk about my friend Chad, and I can move forward. And I thank you all very much.